Hey guys, today we're going to be talking about igneous petrology, specifically volcanic structures for this lecture. And I mentioned in the igneous textures lecture that we'll be talking about igneous structures in a future lecture. Now this is that lecture, but it turns out it's only part one. I started making the igneous structures PowerPoint and quickly realized that I will need two parts for this video because we need to talk about both volcanic structures as well as plutonic structures. So if you remember from our classifications lecture, we talked about extrusive versus intrusive igneous rocks. Go watch that if you are not sure what that is, but basically there are rocks that cool extrusively or out of the earth or at our surface, such as volcanic rocks, and there are igneous rocks that cool within the earth or beneath the earth's surface, and those are intrusive or plutonic rocks, and those create very different structures than the volcanic rocks do. So today specifically we're going to be talking about the igneous structures that occur or form when volcanic rocks cool, as opposed to those that form when plutonic or intrusive rocks cool, which is going to be next lecture. So with that out of the way, let's get started. So first, I just want to mention the difference between igneous textures and igneous structures. We talked all about igneous textures in the previous lecture. If you want to check that out, I'll link it up here for you. But basically, these textures are small scale features on igneous rocks. For example, we have glassy, aphanitic, phanaritic, pegmatitic, porphyritic, and vesicular rocks, and these are all descriptions of the rock's texture. However, structures are larger scale features. So that is what we'll be talking about in this video. And volcanic igneous structures specifically can either be mafic or felsic. And again, if you're not sure what those terms mean, just go check out the classifications video. I'll link it up here for you if you want. But mafic igneous rocks or lavas occur mostly as flows, and felsic igneous rocks occur mostly as pyroclastic deposits or pyroclastic flows, and we'll talk about what those mean, but generally we can see in this picture to the left here, this is more mafic, less viscous, more fluid flow of mafic lava, whereas on the right we have a pyroclastic flow, so you can already get a sense of what these things mean, but again, I will go way more in detail later in the video. But before I go into detail on volcanic igneous structures, I do want to just make sure that you guys understand what I mean by plutonic or intrusive igneous textures. So these are things like lava domes, dikes, and sills for hypabyssal igneous rocks, and hypabyssal is just shallowly intrusive, so kind of up here in this area, you've got some dikes over here, you've got sills in this picture here, and plutonic igneous structures include things like plutons, batholiths, and also sills and dikes as well, and plutons and batholiths are a little bit deeper in Earth's crust, and we can see they're just basically magma bodies, and we'll talk about the types of larger scale structures that these types of intrusive igneous rocks or intrusive igneous magmas cause upon cooling in the next video. So that's just to differentiate these two videos for you if you're not sure what that meant. So going back to volcanic structures, as that is what this video is all about, we'll talk here about volcanic flows and the structures that are associated with such volcanic flows. So this is getting into the more mafic magma flow structures. So when you have mafic lava flows, yes, sorry, I should have said lava. When it's outside of the earth, it's lava. I said magma, excuse me. Anyway, when you have mafic lava flows, these can be divided into two main types. These include lava or blocky lava and pahoehoe lava or ropey lava. And they're exactly what they sound like. Blocky looks like this and ropey looks like this. So pretty accurate to those descriptive words. And when we see these structures in the field, this tells us a little bit about how, when, and from what those structures crystallize from. We know this because pahoehoe, for example, forms when lava is still very hot and fluid, whereas structures or this blocky type of lava forms as lava starts to cool and it begins to break apart. And so it's a little bit cooler and it's not hot and flowy enough to form the ropey structures. It's starting to break apart and so then it becomes blocky. So it's pretty self-explanatory. But getting into maybe some cooler structures, at least in my opinion, you've got columnar jointing. That's another common mafic volcanic structure, and it results when ponded lava cools, or most often when the lava is ponded before it cools. So that just means it goes into a low area, it ponds, and once it starts starts to cool, it contracts and jointing forms typically in this hexagonal structure, and you get this hexagonal jointing structure called columnar jointing. And also they're just really pretty in pictures and really cool. So that's a plus too. And these structures aren't just pretty to look at. They're also helpful for identifying the base and top of the flow. For example, these columns will typically be wider at the base of the lava flow, whereas they will be thinner at the top of the lava flow. So you can come across these columns and then kind of tell where the base of the flow was and where the top of the flow was. So moving on now to another really cool but really different igneous volcanic structure is pillows. And I don't mean soft, squishy pillows that you want to lie your head on. No, these are pretty hard. So I wouldn't recommend sleeping on them, but you know, whatever floats your boat. So anyway, these pillows form when lava cools underwater. That's why I have this cool GIF here of lava cooling underwater. How cool is that? Anyway, it forms these cool pillow structures, or pillow basalts, as they're often called, because the magma that is in contact with the water is chilled and quenches to form these lobate shapes. And these pillows are diagnostic of subaqueous volcanism, or of at least volcanism that had a flow go into water if it didn't start in water to begin with. So you can imagine, for example, at mid-ocean ridges, all of the magmatism that's occurring there is flowing directly into the ocean and therefore forming these pillows. And so that's where we get the most regionally extensive deposits of these pillow basalts. Another structure, which I also mentioned in the textures video, is vesicles. Vesicles are basically just preserved gas bubbles. Vesicles form when the gas exhales from the lava to gather at the top of the lava flow. This is another diagnostic feature that indicates the top of the flow. This is similar to how we can indicate the base and top of the flow using columnar jointing and the thickness of the columns, but the vesicles here just indicate the top of the flow. So if you find a bunch of volcanic rocks and you see vesicles and a lot of it, and then underlying the vesicular part, you have non-vesicular igneous rock, then that's probably the base of the flow, or at least the not top of the flow. And then you've got the vesicular part, which is the top of the flow, because that's just the way the gas moves and how the vesicles form. Okay, so now moving on from mafic volcanic igneous structures, now we're moving into the pyroclastic deposits or pyroclastic structures, which is still volcanic, but instead of mafic, now we're moving toward the more felsic compositions. So felsic, extrusive, or volcanic lavas typically form pyroclastic deposits. And these are classified based on two main factors: size of fragments in the deposit and the relative abundance of glass, crystals, and rock fragments. So let's focus on the size of the fragments first. Basically, we use this ternary diagram to figure out what our pyroclastic deposit is classified as based on the size of the fragments in the deposit. And so we basically have here that anything with larger diameter than about 32 millimeters is called a bomb or a block. And bombs are just clots of magma that were partially or fully plastic when erupted, whereas blocks were already solid when erupted. So they're both large in size, but they're a little bit different in that bombs were not fully solid when erupted and blocks were. Why does that matter? Well, that just means that the shape of bombs is affected by the fluidity of the magma, the length and velocity of flight, and deformation on impact, whereas blocks were already shaped because they were already solid. So that's the only real difference there. If you ever need to identify a bomb versus a block, you can kind of see if it looks like it was impacted by the length and velocity of flight or deformation upon impact. And if it was impacted by those things, or if it seems like it was, then that was probably a bomb. If not, and it's large, then maybe it's block. So you can kind of tell by that. But anyway, back to the size. So anyway, those are the larger size fragments. And then we have lapilli, which are around 4 to 32 millimeters in diameter. And I'm literally just now realizing that the image that I took off of the internet for this ternary diagram is not matching up exactly with the numbers that are in my textbook for the sizes of these fragments. However, for the purposes of this video, just know that bombs and blocks are the big ones, lapilli are the intermediate, and ash, as we'll talk about in the next slide, are the small. You don't really need to know the exact increments of size. sizing unless your professor wants you to. Okay, so with that said, lapilli can either be shaped into finely spun threads called Pele's hair, or they can be concentric layered spheres or pellets that are called accretionary lapilli. Lastly, we have ash, which is material less than 4 millimeters in diameter. And it says tuff here. Tuff is just consolidated volcanic ash. And ash may either be vitric, crystal, or lithic, depending on the proportion of glass crystals and or rock fragments. So now we're moving from the size spectrum or size ternary diagram of pyroclastic deposits into the composition spectrum with these terms vitric, crystal, and lithic. That's what those mean. And so if we look at this ternary diagram, we can see that the relative abundance of glass, crystals, and rock fragments can now be used to further describe your pyroclastic deposit. So if it's mostly glass, it's vitric. If it's mostly rock fragments, it's lithic. And if it's mostly crystals, it's crystal. So now getting into what the actual types of pyroclastic deposits are and how they form and maybe what structures you might expect when you're looking in the field and what they might be diagnostic of. So pyroclastic fall deposits are the first type we'll talk about. Later, we'll talk about pyroclastic flow deposits. So pyroclastic fall deposits are pretty much exactly what they sound like. It's literally pyroclastic material that falls directly out of the sky. So there you go. Thank you for naming that easily, scientists that came before us. So pyroclastic fall deposits can fall over large areas, obviously, because if you have a big boom from a volcano or eruption, then your fall deposits or the material that's falling down can fall over very large areas, especially if it's very fine, such as ash. And we actually see this pretty consistently in the rock record. We see a systematic decrease in thickness and grain size away from the source, the volcanic source. That makes perfect sense because you have your bombs and blocks that are going to drop first, therefore closest to the source, and then the lapilli, which is the intermediate size, and then ash, and then very fine, fine ash. And so we can also see that the thickness of the volcanic ash layer in this example strat column here that we have correlates through these strat columns. We can see that it's thicker over here and thinner over here. So the source is probably closer to the direction in the right side of the slide. So that's kind of how you can look at that and a little bit of the diagnostics you can get from ash deposits or pyroclastic fall deposits in the field. There are two end members or like extremes of pyroclastic fall deposits or the eruptions that cause these types of deposits. And these include Strombolian eruptions and Plinian eruptions. And if I'm pronouncing those wrong, I apologize. I'm not a volcanologist. I just know what I know from reading, not from people saying it out loud. So Strombolian eruptions have a low eruption column, so only 1 to 3 kilometers high, and fragments accumulating around the vent forming a cone, and frequent quiet eruptions, and we can see this in the right figure, whereas Plinian eruptions have a high eruption column, so 20 to 50 kilometers, and they deposit ash layers over a very large area, up to 1 million square kilometers. That's a large area to deposit ash from one volcanic eruption. And we can see that example in the left figure here. And another type of volcanic eruption that can cause pyroclastic fall deposits is Phreatomagmatic. I'm gonna go with that. So phreatomagmatic explosions, eruptions, whatever, happen because when a vent is situated near water, rapid vaporization triggers a violent thermal explosion called a phreatomagmatic explosion. And these explosions form fine-grained glassy ash deposits called hyaloclastite. So we've been talking about pyroclastic fall deposits, but what about pyroclastic flows? Pyroclastic flow deposits form when avalanches of pyroclastic deposits, you know, avalanche down the side of a mountain. I did that sentence wrong, but you know what I mean. So this can be pretty analogous to other types of debris flows. And I talk a lot more about debris flows and the sedimentary types of structures they form in my alluvial fans video. I'll link it up here if you want to check that out. But basically, some of the main differences between pyroclastic fall deposits and pyroclastic flow deposits includes that flow deposits, unlike fall deposits, are poorly sorted with sizes ranging from fine ash to large blocks, because obviously as it's going down this mountain, it's not really having a lot of time to sort Whereas if you are just blowing up a bunch of material into the air, it gives it time to sort out those grains, and the big ones fall first and closest to the vent, and the finer ones fall last and furthest from the vent as well as on top. And therefore you get this like nice normal grading and grading systematically decreasing your grain size away from the vent. And in pyroclastic flow deposits, that doesn't really happen. You don't have the time or area to sort those grains. So poor sorting is the main difference between pyroclastic flow and pyroclastic fall deposits. So that is it for the volcanic structures of this igneous petrology playlist. However, next time, again, we will be going over the plutonic igneous structures. And then the following video, we're going to be talking about phase diagrams. So if you want to check those videos out, I encourage you to do so when they're out, or if they're out now, go check them out now. And with that, I'd like to remind you guys, like I always do, that the textbook I am using to make this lecture is linked in the description. It is Essentials of Igneous and Metamorphic Petrology by Ronald and Carol Frost. So go check that out in the description. I also heavily use that earth materials one I've mentioned in other lectures, but I don't have it with me right now, so I can't hold it up to the screen, but I'll also link that in the description if you want to check those out. So lastly, if you are still sticking around and watching this video, comment down below for me what your favorite volcanic igneous structure is. I personally love the ropey lava structures. That ropey structure seems to me like it can happen in so many different ways, even though it's still the same structure. And it's so cool to me that lava literally cools like that. So that is my favorite. And let me know in the comments what yours is. And thanks for sticking around with me. This was a late filming session, and I'm sure there's going to be a lot of bloopers, so check those out. Bye, guys. Oh, I'm going to take out all of that. This is not a good day. I just spent 12 hours running my XRD samples, and I don't feel like filming. I love doing this, but like, ugh. Okay. Focus, Rachel. I can't take focus. This is gonna be a long blooper section. I hate that I'm wearing a white shirt and like have a light color background. Like, how dumb am I? Okay, I can do this. Relative abundance of grass. Grass? Rachel, oh my gosh. Focus. If it's mostly, I can't speak.